Welcome to the video, and we're just going to chit chat here a little bit. But that's just a facade, okay? Because this morning I was able to do the spiritual practice that is, you have to say, is extraordinary, an extraordinary shift. And so it's about an hour or so afterwards. And I cannot quite, we'll see if I'm able to even explain it as such, but I'm in the wow state of it. Let's just say it was a major, major breakthrough of almost unexplainable consequence. So I'm just, seeing, how do I feel now? I feel fine. I feel normal. But I was practicing the fundamental shift, actually. I actually made it and was able to practice this. And then I went back as I got up and the personality returned. But I did it in the right way, and I understand. And I'll just let it, sink in. I don't want to talk it away. But the ramifications of this are enormous. They're enormous. We're getting to where we want to get to. There's no question about it. And that's a great, great thing. So we can relax here a little bit. The intensity is already here. The intensity, the breakthrough has already happened, actually. But in keeping with our continuity fear, okay, we let it sink in. We let it sink in. Just sit here quietly and chit-chat. We'll talk about the Hurricane Patricia, for instance. This is very fascinating. People are saying, oh, okay. Well, at Miss Manzanillo in Puerto Vallarta, it came through a largely uninhabited area. It's now dissipated. End of story. And I said, well, maybe, maybe not. And something caught my attention. Quixmala, Cuixmala, is where it landed. Straight into Quixmala. What's Quixmala? It's this eco-retreat for the A-listers of the world. This is the place where the super, super wealthy and the megastars, etc., go. Presidents, Reagan, Nixon, Kissinger, for instance. Celebrities, you name it, the celebrities, George Lucas, Tom Cruise, Bill Gates, Mick Jagger, and various other ones. Oh, Madonna, the entertainer, quote unquote entertainer. But we're talking about these ultra, ultra, ultra wealthy people. And the place was founded by this French, super rich, wealthy Frenchman, and then I guess bought by another super wealthy British French corporate raider businessman and rather notorious fellow whose riches are almost unfathomable. Used to be a competitor to the Rothschilds in Europe. His family, ancestry, very notorious fellow. I would say we would disapprove of his lifestyle, a very egoic lifestyle, a heavily continuity fear lifestyle. And they turn it into an eco-resort for these A-listers, where you get fruit picked from these orchards, and they bring it that very day. They pick it, they wash it, they bring it to your table. And it's idyllic setting there in the jungle with all sorts of, wild animals, gazelles and giraffes and all, zebras and, it's just like the ultimate, ultimate luxury resort for these ultra, ultra powerful people in the world. So it spares the poor people of Puerto Vallarta and Manzanillo, the hardworking people. Well, Puerto Vallarta's got a lot of expatriates. There's it's mostly foreigners, with their villas there. But anyway, it spared these big cities and targeted exactly, made landfall at Quixmala. There's this huge hotel. There's Moorish-looking hotel there. And, it's the absolute sybaritic lap of luxury in terms of, catering to the flesh. and these notorious celebrities, we would say, and politicians, this is where they hang out. Rates start about $2,000 a night, up to like about $4,000 a night. That's nothing for them, you know, it's pocket change. And, you know, it's the picture shows just beautiful beaches and palm trees. I mean, just think, it's like, this is paradise. This is paradise here in this world. Okay, this is where this most powerful storm in history made landfall. And if anybody wants to say, this is sheer coincidence, go ahead. If they want to say, oh, well, just coincidence, really? This storm popped up and intensified. Actually, they're saying in 12 hours' time, it went from a tropical depression, tropical storm maybe, to the most powerful storm in history in 12 hours, and it made landfall in Kuxmala, in this super luxury hideout for these notorious people, you might say. The uber, uber wealthy and powerful, the ones behind the scenes that have extraordinary control and manipulation of financial markets and public opinion, and social engineers of the highest order, okay? Social engineers of the highest order. For instance, Madonna and Mick Jagger, I mean, my God, what have they done for this planet? I mean, to put the two of them together. I was watching the Billboard Top 100 of 1979 or 80 or 78, and I went through all the top songs. And I said, okay, look at them. And then suddenly a song popped up, and I said, oh, I miss you. You know, Mick Jagger's. I saw Mick Jagger's. Oh, my God. He said, he looks like some reptilian devil. I mean, I just his vision, the whole vibration, this guy, there's a film clip, you know, of him singing this song. I said, he just stood out. He just stands out even now. Just holy cow. And then, of course, Madonna is the, you know, the epitome of notoriousness as far as pulling culture down, pulling high culture down into trash. These are the people that stay at this hotel. Among others, of course. Of course, many will feel they're very respectable people, personalities. But, and then, you know, I mean, these are people that need to hide away, you know, you might say, from the people. Kissinger, you know, I mean, come on, these people, holy cow. The uber, uber, uber wealthy, with good reason to hide away, the uber, uber social engineers, those who are heavily responsible for the cultural situation that we're in right now. One of their super, super hideaways, okay? Kaboom. Most powerful storm in history. Hits right there. Goes right through. Now, they said all the guests were relocated out of the way. Well, of course. They probably flew them, jumped in an airplane and flew them somewhere. I don't know how they do it. But, however, the symbology is not lost on any of us. And as we say, this world is nothing but a projection of our own thoughts. Well, just imagine the intensity of projected thoughts that suddenly morphed into this, what we call a Hurricane Patricia, that hit this spot directly. And keep in mind that these social engineers are the ones who have helped shape everyone's thoughts here in this world. So just imagine what could be coming upon this world, if you look at it this way. So this is an extreme wake-up call for the world. It is not a coincidence that what happened there. And of course the media, these things are lost on the personality level. Doesn't see this. It doesn't see this. So you need someone who's speaking from the level of spirit who can see this. Bill Gates, I mean, he's responsible for massive social engineering, right? Continues to be one of the biggest social engineers on the planet. Philanthropically, of course. Yeah, that's what philanthropy's for, but they're actually social engineering projects, most of them. Goes on and on and on. These are just a few of the more notorious names, but I'm sure there's a vast number of them. This is the A-listers, A-hangout, okay? Tucked away there out of the way of all civilization, you know, with exotic luxuries there right on the beach. And, well, I wonder if they have a beach left. I sincerely doubt it. I wonder if they have any palm trees left. I sincerely doubt it. You're talking about devastation that rolled through that resort. Like a vacuum cleaner. Now people will be saying, yeah, that's God's wrath. No, it's not. God is not wrathful. God is only absolute peace, absolute sovereignty, absolute love, absolute freedom, absolute bliss. This is a result of projected thoughts. This is a projection of appetite for destruction. This is it's the result of projected thoughts. Turmoil. Remember I said, shake him, not stir. Well, this is stirred. You know, they're stirring. These are the ones who are really stirring things up in the world. Taking us away from the non-dual focus, okay, here in this world. Taking us away from high spirituality. These are the ones that are stirring it up. And those projected thoughts came back as a big stir. So their little hideaway is no mas. Now they'll probably, you know, pay to bring back in palm trees, and they'll plant them, and they'll reconstitute it, maybe. Or maybe they decide, you know what, this is not a good place, let's they'll migrate to other hideaways that they have on the planet. But it just goes to show you, even the top A-listers and their perceived nirvana here in this world is not safe from perishability, is it? Not in the slightest bit. This just emphasizes perishability, this belief system of perishability. Money doesn't insulate you from it at all. In fact, it'll come out back and bite you severely. And before people start celebrating, say, oh, okay, they got theirs. Keep in mind, this whole planet has been socially engineered by these people. And everyone's emitting these type of thoughts and beliefs, projecting all this. And it's all going to come back upon us here. Unless we repent. Unless we repent. This is a term often used in the Bible for those who are projecting extremely violent, you know, projecting terrible perishability thoughts. It comes back on them. And the prophets would go and say, repent, repent, repent. It's the only way you can avoid destruction, because we see that your thoughts are coming back upon you. They didn't put it that way. Say, the wrath of the Lord, you have sinned. But this is just a symbolic way of talking. They didn't really have the sophistication that we have today in terms of psychological terms. And a better understanding of the dynamic, but they're aware of it, certainly. And like Jonah went to Nineveh and said, hey, Nineveh, you know, you're going to be wiped out if you don't repent. And they repented, and they were spared for a while. You know, you could diminish the intensity of these projected thoughts, of the dynamic that, it's just a dream dynamic, but the dynamic of these thoughts coming back to the source, boomeranging back. And people call it karma. They call it karma, the boomeranging effect. You can lessen this. It's possible to greatly lessen this, actually. And ultimately, make a shift so there's no effect whatsoever. Which is what this practice I did this morning. So I've been able to do this, at least in practice, a very intense practice for a long time. And then I said, okay, it's, you know, it's weakening a little bit. But I did a tremendous job in experiencing this shift. So I wanted to experience it. I have. I say, okay, I can do this. It's not. It didn't shake me up too much. It was fantastic. I'd be stuck in the personality, and then I'd just shift right out of the personality, entirely. And I'd state my authority. I am this spirit. I am the sole authority. Always have been. Always will. There is no authority. I am this perfect light, which has no blemish. It's absolutely flawlessly perfect. No blemish. There's no challenge. There's no dynamic challenge in this whatsoever. It is all have perfect perfection everywhere. You know, this is my authority that I am giving to all. This is my spiritual will, my spiritual authority. And this is the only authority there is, the I am authority. So I was practicing many different ways, and the personality would reassert itself. And then I just, instead of struggling with that, I just reassert my authority. And it would vanish, just like that. The whole personality complex would just vanish. So I just kept doing that. I said, wow, this is fun, just playing with this. And I said, okay, well, all right. Now it personality comes back a little bit. Now, that's okay. What wins? Familiarity wins. So, I'm getting used to it. I said, okay, yeah. Now I see what the shift is how it's done. Now I just have to let the wow settle down, that's all. Just sit here quietly. So actually, all this boomerang, all this effects can completely vanish because you simply assert your will that there are no such effects. You see, all of this, what we're doing is, it's like a bluff. We're bluffing. We're saying, if we go along with lessening our authority, then when the new authority comes along, it won't be so severe upon us. I'll take it easy on you because at least you tried to play ball with us. So this is all a bluff. There is no other authority. But I just said, okay, fine. But in the meantime, I'm going to assert perfect authority that there is no other authority. Never has been and never will be. And there's no exceptions to this whatsoever. And say, well, okay, if you're going to be some other authority, fine. Let me help you see what it's like to be the true sovereign authority. And I'll showcase it for you. But I thanked myself for bringing this up. What happened was there was this kind of dream figure that brought this up and claiming that it was going to make a deal with me, and it would go easy on me if I made this deal. When it assumed total authority, that I would be treated nicely if I made this deal. And I said, wait a minute, you know, this is a trick, this is a bluff. But then I thank this figure for bringing this to my attention. And so there's this positive, you know. And as soon as I did that, I was able to practice because I recognized this is just my own projection of continuity fear coming to my attention, because I said, hey, it's time to tackle this issue here. So it is possible to have a very positive relationship even with your defenses, with the ego, with all of this. You do not have to be in an adversary role position whatsoever. Be in a thankful, grateful, whatever comes up, say, thank you, that's exactly what I needed to see. And so it'll actually help you. You know, you'll be helped in every way by your entire dream, actually. It'll bring to your attention what you need to focus on and practice on. And so I had this very positive feeling all throughout. And thank you for the obstruction, for this bluff, for all this, you know, stuff, because it shows me exactly where I need to focus now. So this resulted in, if I was struggling with that, I wouldn't have been able to practice. But because I took that tact, the practice was easy. Easy. So just have this feeling of tremendous gratitude to yourself. Jesus calls it forgiveness. I call it gratitude, I would say. Tremendous feeling of gratitude. And just say, thank you so much. This is just incalculably valuable to me. Wow. So to get into the wow, just thank your defenses for being incalculably valuable to you to draw your attention to what you need to shift out of. Okay? And then it's just wow. Be grateful for it. Then just feel the wow, this is so great that I see what I need to shift out of, what I can need to shift out of right now. And that's what I did in the practice. The personality kept reasserting itself, and I just go, wow, that's great. Now I get to practice shifting out of this. So there was not this adversarial, conflictual situation within me. Tremendous validation of all the work that I've done. being willing to speak up on areas that no one else wants to speak up on, and getting to this positive inner harmony that helps us make a shift. There is a fundamental basic shift. That we need to make, and we can practice it. It's not like kaboom. I just started practicing it. It was very easy. I just asserted, I am the soul, one and only soul authority of all that is and will ever be, and it's all right now. And on and on and on. I can't quite remember all the assertions I made. I don't want to struggle with it, but I was able to assert in a way I've never been able to assert before. And it's very clear that this is practicing the shift, abidance actually, practicing abidance. I was like bringing in the light, they call it, just affirming the light as it is. I say, I radiate in all directions from the now, everywhere. It's equally, blessed by my perfect authority, by this perfect light. Everyone has all benefits. Always. Everyone, everywhere has all benefits always from my will, from my spiritual authority. And this is my assertion of my spiritual authority. All has all benefits always, everywhere. And there's no exception or blemish or even ripple upon this. And I kept asserting like this and more intensely and as far as wellness, and my authority asserts that all are perfectly well, that the body does not interfere. Nothing interferes with our perfect satisfaction. Nothing can ever fear under my authority. Nothing can ever fear with perfect satisfaction, and nothing can ever contravene my authority in any way. On and on and on like this, the I am authority. And we can assert this, and we don't realize it. We can actually assert this. And it's bringing in the light. It's bringing in the peace. And I realized this is this absolute peace. There are no thoughts. I need not think any thoughts because there is no opposition. There is no other condition. This is my authority. There's simply this the one condition of my authority. There isn't anything else. So there's no need to think, no thoughts, nothing. As soon as thoughts came in, I would just shift into the assertion and the thoughts would just vanish. All thoughts would vanish. There's only the assertion. Now people might be saying, wow. Yeah, well, I'm just, I said like after just sit quietly, right? This is the last video I did. Planet Popcorn is about to pop. Is just, when you see it, you're asserting it, you realize it, you just have the body sit quietly. And I told them, just under my authority, the body can just sit quietly in peace, just inert. Does not get in the way, does not feel anything, doesn't get in the way, causes no obstruction, causes no problem whatsoever. Everything is flawlessly perfect always. We can never suffer in any way whatsoever. We're flawlessly perfect and blissful and free. And this is all places, everywhere, always. This is my authority. This is what I assert. And there is no other authority. So I did this when I woke up early in the morning. I was just slept in and just kept asserting this and working on it. I said, I'll get up when I'm done. And then I got out of bed. It's Saturday morning. It's a good time to really do, very intense. Now, nobody can tell there's been this, incredibly important breakthrough. I'm just sitting here, normal, like every day. Quiet, just no discernible difference. But the intensity of this practice, I'm just, I don't know what effect it will have. It must have, I don't know. We'll see. You would think it would have some effect, really. It was that profound. But I'm just showcasing, you can, no matter how profound the practice and experience, you can just sit here quietly, the body can just sit here quietly. and I realized, Ramana Maharshi, I realized this, that what the stillness he was in, I realized, oh, that's it. He realized his perfect authority, the perfect I am authority, and just was abiding in that. And there's nowhere I need to go to assert this authority. This authority is right here, right now, everywhere. I don't need to gallivant about. I don't need to talk about it. It's already present. There's nothing contravening it in the slightest bit. So there's nothing to argue. There's no arguments needed at all. There's nothing contravening. There's nothing standing in the way. There is no other authority other than this. So he could just sit there quietly like that. Because he's the total authority, right? I mean, the I am is perfect authority. Nothing stands in his way. Nothing can even remotely even be thought to stand in his way. There is no question about whatsoever. So he doesn't need to go anywhere or say anything or do anything at all. And so this is the body just sat there like this. It's just a symbol saying, look, I don't need to do anything. I'm total perfect authority. What need do I have to go put out fires or do this? No need whatsoever. So it's a profound, profound statement of truth, Ramana Maharshi. The real king doesn't need to travel about the kingdom trying to set things right. The real king's kingdom is seamless, totally seamless, perfect, flawless. Nothing ever stands in the way. And so I got that. I mean, I recognized all of this just in the practicing. I said, wow, okay, I see what it's all about now. Yeah. And then, so, do I need to go running around? No. Can you go? Sure. But there's no concern or effort or botheration. There's only here, there's only now. There's only the here-nowness of this perfect authority. Unchallenged, completely unchallenged. And unchallengeable. Forever unchallengeable. Eternal life in all directions, forever unchallengeable. So what's crucial is to realize that you can just sit quietly after this. This is what, again, I'm showcasing. When you have this inner accord and you no longer feel that that these defenses are an adversary role anymore, that they're actually helping us focus on what we need to practice, then we don't have to assert anything over the body, you know, like you need to do this, go there, say this, or that. No, just let the body sit quietly. And this in turn helps our practice again. And how did this again arise? Because of this positive relationship I now have with, I call it the land of long faces, of they set me free. I promise to honor, you know, time, our creativity, by honoring time, not worshiping it, but honoring it. And then we have a positive relationship now with all defensiveness and all suffering, all of that. They trusted me that I'll do the right thing. So here's this figure telling me that it'll go easy on me if I just live a life of suffering and misery and deny my authority as much as possible. It'll go good for me when that figure has total authority over me. And I said, ah, okay, this is what I need to practice. Now this is what I need to practice. That's how it happened. And I just shifted out of that. I said, well, okay, great for you, but right now I'm the sole authority there is, and there isn't any authority, never will other authority, nor will there ever be. Jesus said, love your enemies. This is what he's talking about. I mean, you know, the figures that show up to block you, love them because they're showing you what you can, what you need to practice. They're showing you what you need to practice. I said, hey, the only way to practice is to just shift out of this and claim my own authority. There's no other way. You see? So I was ready to practice this. That's why this complex, you know, arose, this bluff arose. So I could, it would clue me into, this is what I need to practice. Okay. So again, we're just sitting here chit-chatting, really, but the intensity is present. Intensity is present. Just feel the wow. My weight's going down a little bit. That's good. I'm sticking with it. This is, you know, very positive. What's the day? It's like October 24th, isn't it? The 70th anniversary of the United Nations. And it's also, what, Back to the Future Day today, I think? The 24th? Very profound day today. For many reasons, actually. And today, this morning, is the day I was able to practice the fundamental shift that we have to make. So this has been, this touchdown, you might say, this is touchdown here, this practice, this shift, is presenting itself now to me. Super auspicious. And we, you know, we were aiming for this, absolutely. And more to come in October, no question about it. 27th is also a very important day. Very important. Isn't that the 27th? Today's the 24th. 25th. That's when the World Series starts, isn't it? The 111th World Series. Now, we saw the rapid boomeranging of Hurricane Patricia upon this area, Cuxmala. Week smaller, whatever you want to call it. And expect rapid boomerang. It's like this boomerang is coming back. Now, when the, you know, the boomerang's coming back, we don't see it for a while. We're not paying attention. What happens, like when it gets real close, we see it suddenly. Wham! That's how this maybe that bee, all these circles the bee was making. It's actually a boomerang shape. If you were to look in there, the shape is a semicircle, like a boomerang. And this bee was showing me not only the cyclonic effect of this hurricane, but even more intense as I look at it now. It's all in a semicircular shape, the dust trails of the dust in a boomerang shape. So I think the bee is saying that all this boomeranging, projected thoughts coming back to us, we don't recognize until it gets real close, and then wham, it suddenly jumps out of nowhere, it seems to. So, again, this Hurricane Patricia was just a tropical depression. Nobody was paying any attention to it at all, really. Oh, you know, maybe a little tropical moisture's coming, some rain, we'll take a look, you know. In 12 hours, it turned into the most powerful storm in history. This has to get our attention, especially spiritually. This is our thoughts, projected thoughts, coming back like a boomerang effect, and suddenly it jumps up and bites us, you know. So, what the Holy Spirit's been telling me with urgency is this boomerang effect will pop up like popcorn all over the world. Pop, 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 pop. It could happen. It could really, really happen. It could happen monetarily. It could happen militarily. It could happen ideologically happen. Super fast change is likely to happen in the world right now. And this Hurricane Patricia is a warning sign to the world. So we need to realize we can make this shift out of the personality into spirit. This world is just the projection of personality, trying to deceive God, and God thinking that God made this projection, you know, personality, instead of spirit, instead of its true creation, you know, instead of God's true creation. So this shift is all important, and the very same, you know, time frame that Hurricane Patricia came in, I started focusing on this shift and was able to start practicing it. So, you know, we're right on track here. Personality will keep playing, okay, it's fiddle, but we keep practicing, we keep focusing on the wow of this, like, wow, we're succeeding, wow, we're going to succeed. This is the wow. The big wow is that we're going to actually succeed here. This is the wow. Just feel that. Yes, we can. Yes, we will. Yes, we already have succeeded. Yes, we can. Yes, we will. Yes, we already have succeeded. Yes, we can succeed. Yes, we will succeed. Yes, we have already succeeded. So I've been dieting for how long? 56 days, about. Sorry, about the 29th. Well, maybe more than that. 30 and 24 is 54. 29, 30, 31, 54, 50, 57, but maybe call it 56, starting, you know, really getting into on the morning of the 30th, you might say, 56 days. Of dedicated dieting. How many pounds I've lost? 15 pounds. 15 pounds in 56 days. That's like a pound, almost, you know, a pound every 4 days, a little better than that. At first it goes rapidly, right? You think, wow, it shouldn't take long at all. Then it plateaus out, and then starts going back up, and then you go down, and then you have these various plateaus, and you feel like losing your, you know, initiative. You think, oh, I'm not getting anywhere. But ultimately what happens is ultimately your stomach shrinks, and then you're able to then hit to go at it even more intensely, which I'm doing with smoothies now, fruit smoothies. Okay, so we'll just chit chat a little here. It's just wow. It's just, you know, yes, we can succeed. Yes, we will succeed. Yes, we have succeeded. We have succeeded, actually. And this wow can just pulsate. Just feel this wow. Because it's true. It's true. Yes, we can succeed. Yes, we will succeed. Yes, we have already succeeded. So this is wow. Just whew, I'll talk about fruit smoothies. See, I found an easier way to do it, which helps out in the diet. We want simplicity. We want ease. You don't want to struggle with it. So what did I do? I'll tell you what I did. This is just a wonderful tip and advice here. To make it easier, that's what I do. I give advice to make the spiritual focus, make spiritual focus, non-dual wow focus, to walk here in the wow and make it easier. I give advice to make it easier. Food, you know, is a big issue, isn't it, right? Well, my gosh, food plays such a small role in my life right now. I don't even have to think about it. Hardly. Shrink the stomach up, that helps a lot. In other words, don't eat big quantities. Don't you know, stretch the stomach out. This is a big problem. So keep the quantity small. And ultimately, I've gone over to a liquid diet mostly, which helps the stomach shrink even more, right? It's very helpful. But it's a good liquid diet. What I've done is very simple. Go down to the supermarket and buy these bags, like Dole, I think, makes them, of frozen fruit. Peaches, cantaloupes, strawberries, grapes, and then there's another one that makes it with all these berries, raspberry, blueberry, boysenberry, all the berry mix, heavy on antioxidants. So I put the Dole fruit mix, frozen fruit, in the Nutribullet glass, that you put on the Nutribullet and it blends it all up. Nutribullet's very, very effective, very easy to use. We got it last Christmas, so I've been trying to I forgot to put the kale and spinach in this morning. Well, I'll do that in my other, I'll do that. Probably forgetting on purpose, but I'm going to do this. I put in the fruit. Then I also at the market, I buy this Odwalla protein drink. It could be tropical flavor, protein, mango flavor, vanilla flavor, whatever. They have these protein drinks with like 30 grams of protein in them, etc. Super health food drinks. And they're in fairly small bottles. I pour that in for liquid, pour it in, and then I also pour in some cranberry coconut juice or whatever, lemonade, cranberry something. Or there's some, it could be any juice drink, apple juice, whatever. Cranberry seems to mix well. And top it off with that. And then put the top on, put in the Nutribullet, boom, and in a minute or less, you've got your smoothie. If you put too much frozen fruits in, it turns into just a really thick, icy, and the blade can't go properly, and it actually starts vibrating, and it'll loosen up the top on you and be a mess. That happened to me once. So you don't want to put too much fruit in yet. Make sure you have quite a bit of juice in there also, so it can still stay fairly liquid. I have the smoothie right here, part of it I'm drinking. So you put about that much of fruit in, about that much, and then leave this part for the juice, so it stays liquidy and doesn't turn into an icy. And that's it. Then I drink it. Not too fast, you get roof burn, freeze your roof of your mouth, which is no fun at all. And then I supplement that. I eat a hard-boiled egg occasionally, some peanut butter, if I feel hungry. But, it's okay to feel hungry. I'm feeling a little hungry right now, as a matter of fact. But, so, it's so simple. Out of the freezer, fruits, frozen fruits in. Out of the freezer, protein drink, some juice, Nutribullet. Vroom, you're ready, start drinking, you're off for the day. I just carry it with me during the day, working, wherever. I just have it whenever I'm thirsty, just drink the smoothie. That's it. Done. No cooking, no cleanup, no preparation time other than about a minute, maybe a minute or two at the most. There you have it. That's my food consciousness right now. It's minimal. Very important to knock out the snacks. Don't have a bunch of snacks lying around. Especially, I find the most notorious diet buster of all, what is the worst of all, that you just cannot have around the house? Corn chips, potato chips, corn chips with dip, Because, they're addictive. You go through a bag, in a day, or, a whole bag with heavy dip. That just destroys your diet. It stretches your stomach. It puts on 2 pounds. I mean, it's just terrible. So there's certain things you cannot do. And I can still eat a few sweets. I take just a bite of it or something. It's nice. It's not a problem. Had this wonderful bread pudding that I was eating yesterday. But not a lot of it. I just, take a bite here and a bite there. It's the snacks that are the killers. Really. I love potato chips, especially the salty ones, but have to stay away from those. Those are just, wow, terrible. And there are other stuff that's really bad, too. Overeating is really terrible. Anything cooked with a lot of grease, a lot of oil, fried is very bad. Now, if I want to eat something solid, I'll have like a salad, spinach and you know, various leafy green salad with some pine nuts and some onions, red sweet onions, and some feta cheese. Or I'll have just a Greek yogurt, a Faget Greek yogurt with some walnuts and blueberries, you know, just maybe I'll have, you know, have that for lunch if I need it. But that's very quick. Just open it up, put the walnuts in, eat it. You're done in a couple minutes. That's it. No prep, no cleanup. So food is an extreme habit we have. Very difficult to break the food habit. I must have realized that it's time to break the food habit. In the summer, I decided to just eat whatever I wanted to eat. You know, cake. I just eating cake and cheesecake and ice cream and mixing up whipped cream on it and just whatever. And I was doing that. Chocolate cake, and then I'd have this, you know, mixture of four or five different kinds of ice cream with walnuts and whipped cream and fudge, hot fudge sauce, and then potato chips with that and macaroni salad and just whatever. So I just binge, and then, you know, just blew up like a blimp. But I said, okay, that was fun. But now it's time, you know, to get serious here, get down to business. So 56 days of getting away from that, and here I am with these smoothies, and it's not a problem. But you know, it takes a while to alter our habits, even when we're very, yeah, sincerely intent upon it. It still takes a while, and you go through phases, and you have to maintain your will. I saw a chocolate bar. Some store that, you know, they have these little jars full of chocolate bars and things just for the customers. And I said, oh, that'd be nice. Let me just take that chocolate bar. And I said, no, don't do that. And I didn't. So these little efforts of will are necessary, because for me, eating a chocolate bar when you're trying to fast is the worst thing possible. This is what's called a fast buster, is to start eating chocolate bars, chocolate in general. It's always a sign that I'm going in the wrong direction. For me, it's amazing how accurate that sign is. As soon as I start reaching for chocolate bar, I say, what the heck? I know that my will has burned out, and I'm now going to go back and start eating whatever I want to eat, and I'll start off with a chocolate bar. It just is sort of a shift of will. It's actually just symbolizes a shift of will. So I said no to the chocolate bar. I said no. I'm you know, I've got some goals here. It's important. Trying to be more disciplined, doing more stretching exercises. Actually, I'm following through on that, believe it or not. The back has healed up a bit from the golf. No more golf right now. Stretching. Next thing, we'll see if I actually can do it or not. It's a matter of will. Once you start something, you know, then you realize you're sort of going to start committing to something, and so starting is difficult. Starting a commitment is difficult. But moving around better, most definitely. Feeling better. It just takes this commitment, and then you want to keep going. You don't want to, you know, blow it up and stop it and just say, the heck with it. I just don't feel that way. Now, when you're really committed like this, then you know, if you get invited to dinner or something, you can go out and eat something. Don't eat too much. But then you go right back to the smoothies or whatever. And it's not, that's not going to, you know, cause a problem. It's the snacking. It's the stomach. You have to keep it, the stomach, shrunken. Now, drinking this cold smoothie is also very helpful, because it's so cold, this contracts the stomach too. It helps contract the stomach. This is a secret too for eating. If you drink 2 glasses of cold water before you eat, and this will cut your appetite way down. Now, these are all nice tips and advice, but you know, who follows through on them? I've actually never done that. Drink 2 glasses of cold water. But I know it'll work. That's how stubborn we are and resistant we are. Oftentimes we do not follow advice at all. However, it's some way the advice gets through to us, and we do say, you know, there is a way to do this. I'll do it my own way, but there is a way. I stopped throwing bananas in the smoothies because, you know, bananas have quite a few calories. And that's okay, you know. But I am going to try and put spinach and kale in there. I kind of need the green leafy vegetables. I don't think it really changes the taste that badly. I will do that. I made a mistake, too much frozen fruit. So I had two of these glasses, and I just dumped half in and half in, then put more juice, so it's now liquid. But that means I have another one of these waiting for me. And I will put a whole bunch of spinach and kale. And that gives you a really, really powerful, you know, healthy boost. Superfoods. I'll put some superfood stuff in that. Absolutely. Now, do you get tired of it? Well, you don't get tired of the efficiency of it and the ease of it and all that. But it's time to time you say, you know, wow, a little bit tired of it, but again, you know, if you can balance off the ease and efficiency and quickness, and you get your mind on something else, you know, we'll see. We'll see. But adding that protein drink in there is really helpful. It means I'm getting, you know, a lot of vitamins, minerals, and protein from it. Fruit just in itself doesn't really have, you know, enough for us. And protein, dealing with protein powder is a little pain. It's kind of a pain. How much of the it was 2 for $4 one time, 2 for $5, these protein drinks. I use about half a bottle for one, so it was like 2 for $4. That would be just like $1 in protein drink, $1. The fruit is about $4, $4.50. Let's call it $5. And I use about an eighth of it or so. So 50 cents, let's just call it $1 there too, okay, round up. So it's about a $2 for breakfast. Smoothie costs about, and the juice, let's say about $2. Not bad, huh? Not bad. Also, you can put Greek yogurt into the smoothie too. I do that also. That gives you also a big kick of calcium and protein. You know, another helpful. Why not make a yogurt fruit smoothie, Greek yogurt fruit smoothie. And my go-to nut is walnuts. I love walnuts. They go really good with just eat them separately, or you can put them on your yogurt or something. Very nice walnuts. As we're just chilling out here, just chatting after the enormously great news of this practice of being shifting authority from the personality to I am. We can practice it, and this great, great breakthrough here, great touchdown. Great touchdown here in the world. I'm using that foam roller to help with my stretching. Be careful you don't use a foam roller too much in your lower back. I have having lower back problems because it stretches out too much. Don't do too much of that, actually. I use it for stretching out the flexibility in the legs, actually, and hamstrings and hips and all that, by sitting on it and then rocking and going forward and stretching. It's very helpful for that. Sort of different way of doing it. I'm sort of tired of doing the traditional stretching exercise of bending over and touching your toes and stuff. There's a different way. Maybe the lazy person's way of doing it. As you get older, maybe this is a benefit. So you want flexibility. You want to slim down. You want flexibility, slim down, flexibility. You know, minimize the food consciousness thing. Go somewhere where there's a television on. They're always talking about food. Most people have it on the food channel. It's just food. This is a very bad thing. People are talking today, how they, you know, all about oysters. Now we had, you know, oysters from all over the world, this huge platter, we tasted this and this and that, and they're describing how it tasted and did this and this and this and this and this. And there's this massive food consciousness building on the planet. So what we're doing is we're sidestepping this, right? So intelligently, artfully, because it's not like we're fighting against the food thing by no food. We still can talk about it, because when in Rome, do as Romans do. But here we are just showing how we can simplify our food consciousness to an extraordinary extent. And be very healthy, be super healthy. I mean, as far as the body getting what it, you know, ultimately health of the body is simply our authority by stating it so, actually. Why didn't Ramana have a perfectly healthy body? Because he didn't want to, at that point, have people fixate on the body and that sort of thing. Because with I am authority, there's only perfect wellness. There's only perfect wellness. The body doesn't do anything one way or the other to affect it. So I didn't want people fixating, I need a healthy body, what do I need to do for a healthy body? Didn't want them fixating on that. But he could have had perfectly healthy, body could have been perfectly healthy forever, actually. Same thing with Ananda Maimash. He said, well, you know, this is what you expect, so I'll let the body age as you expect it to, but it's just, there's no need for it. I could have it appear to be perfectly in perfect condition forever if I wanted to. No problem whatsoever. That's my authority to say so, and it is so. So, we're still honoring time, so we, you know, talk about a little bit of food consciousness, because if we don't do any of it, it might seem so severe, right? If we just drop food consciousness entirely right now, you know, it would be too tough for everybody, because there's this incredible food consciousness thing in the world now. People are obsessed with it, because there's more food available, more varieties available. If you have the money, you know, you can just get, well, you just go anywhere, any store. Now, it's ridiculous. Every grocery store is expanding like crazy to just hold this in massive variety of foods, and you can just get overwhelmed by this. Oh, I need to try this. Oh, I need to try this. Oh, these are some Belgian, I know these are some Bolivian peas, you know, roasted Bolivian peas. It's from a different country. It's from a different area. It's more organic. It's more, you know, it's more natural. It's more ethnogenic. It's more... I got to try this repackage. It's like this package, you know, red rice from, you know, the marshes and... High Andes of Peru, red rice. Oh gosh, you know, I gotta eat this. I'll really get the vibe of the planet then, you know. I'll get the eco vibe. So people are on this extreme eco trip, but it's all foodiness, you know, in many ways, but it's heavily foodiness, the eco tripping foodies. So maybe I'll get, you know, if you want to just co-opt the whole thing, which we need to, is, you know, get some of this ultra eco food stuff and just put it in your smoothie, you know, throw some chia seeds in there and some the berries, I don't even know, the acai berries or something, and you know, throw the kale in there, and you know, just you know, sprinkle a little bit in there, you won't even taste it or notice, and say, yeah, I know, I'm eco tripping too. Because this is what's happening in the world. We're all ego-tripping right now. And it's pointless to fight against it, tell you the truth. It's not wise, you know. It's not artful. Co-opt the whole thing. Co-opt the whole situation. Just like we're co-opting the whole spirituality thing of worshiping time. Co-opt all that. Co-opt the ego-tripping. Co-opt all this stuff. And simplify it, and then that enables us then to get to practice much more easily. Much more easily. Don't fight against the inner dynamics. Co-opt it in a friendly way, in a kind way, and thank it all, and say, thank you for bringing my attention to this. This will help me help co-opt it properly, you know, and get back to asserting the I am authority, which is what the shift we have to make from this quote-unquote personality, which is all just a bluff, really, to the I am. I amness. And so there may be this play. I don't know how it will go. It's possible. You got to realize that you cannot get too caught up in the play, though, you know. It should be done artfully and minimally. There's a problem of people getting too enthusiastic about the play of co-opting all this nonsense of the personality. Do it simply, humbly, without too much fanfare, I would say. I've done a lot of that. Sri Sri Anandamayama helped me with that. She showed me all the spirituality stuff and says, try this, try this, try this, try this, try this, try this. So I've been through all of that, you know. Dress up as a demigod or a demigoddess and put on all the accoutrements and, you know, just I've been through all of that. So all that stuff, just like, yeah, whatever, been there, done that. It's called firebreaking or co-opting. But you move on from it. It's not an end in itself, but it's an artful practice. Had all the beads, you know, the malas, the beads, you know, whatever. You know, you just wear it for a while and take it off. Say, okay, that's not it. And okay, that's not it. Okay, that's not it. You know, okay. That does, you know, okay, but whatever. Eco-tripping, spiritualizing, spiritual tripping. But don't get stuck in that. Advice is helpful from those who have done it. Not to get stuck in it. You can go even faster, you know, sort of help pioneer this here in this time and place, and so I know what can be done, and you don't want to overdo it. Because that, you know, that's like saying I am a super co-opter of eco tripping, and no, it's just a little goes a long way. Actually, a little goes a long way. And by the way, there's nothing wrong. There's nothing wrong with being ecologically sensitive. No, it's a good thing. There's nothing wrong with it. When it's an end in itself, we become deluded, you know, severely deluded, thinking, not realizing this is just all just a projection of our mental thoughts. It's just we don't want it to get control of our consciousness, because the real goal is the shift that we can make from out of the personality into the authority of the personality, which claims that we need to listen to its authority because it's offering us a deal, which will end up being, in hindsight, a great deal for us, because it's going to treat us nicely once it's the true authority. That's the personality. We shift out of that into true I am authority. Now that I've seen this and practice it, this is a, you know, big advantage now. I understand what's possible now, and I understand what the teachers are trying to get us to, the great teachers. No question about it. This is what they're trying to get us to, this practice. Of shifting, this practice of shift. The neither nor practice helps stabilize the whole situation and brings about this inner accord of harmony within us. And this then enables this shift to happen. So this is what the goal is, they're aiming for. And so now that I know, you know, I don't want to predict, but I just say this is very advantageous. The wow is still there, so I don't want to push things forward to be careful. When you start getting nervous trying to push forward, it means the wow is, you're still very sensitive and the wow is still there, very strong. So just stop. Just stop and honor the wow. See, honor the wow. Honoring the wow is honoring time. Okay? This is honoring time. This is how we honor time, by honoring the wow. And our inner landscape, inner psyche, accepts this and says, great, that's good for me, good for you, done deal. Yeah, that's fine. This is what's so extraordinary. The wow is neither yes nor no, is it? It's not yes, it's not no, it's not both, it's not neither. It's just a wow. And it's both and it's neither, and it's both and neither, and it's neither both and nor neither. The abode of peace, Quixmala, I think it means something like abode of peace or something. Well, didn't turn out to be too peaceful there for him. So you might say it's the personality. It's the really abode of the personalities. People who go there are personalities, high octane personalities, telling the world that this is where it's at. Personality is where it's at. Well, guess what? Boomerangs. The boomerang effect. The end of an age is just when the boomerang comes back around. People go, uh-oh, got to throw out another boomerang. Got hit with that one, let me throw another one out. No, don't throw anything out. There's nowhere to throw it to. I'm, my authority is all and everywhere and flawless and perfect. And there's nowhere where it isn't. I am authority, my authority. Just call it my authority for... Don't make it cumbersome. My authority is everywhere and always. There's no movement at all in it. There's no motion at all in it. There's nothing happening at all in it. It's everywhere, always. So it seems as though the boomerang effect hit the those most intense personalities in the world, hit them first, at least symbolically. It hit their hangout, which is like hitting them. I mean, the personality loves these hangouts, okay, tropical hangouts, these beautiful. This is very important for the personality. To them it's a symbol they've made it, that they're an awesome personality. Lounging in this idyllic cove, beach cove with palm trees everywhere, you know, completely isolated from the rest of the world. Nobody can get to him. No paparazzi can get to him. and just taking a dip, walking back, drinking a tropical drink, having delivered to them mangoes and papayas and guavas, you know, cut up in beautiful fruit thing, and eating it fresh, you know, just picked this morning, and you know, just detoxifying, you know, and relaxing. This is very important for these for personality. Extraordinarily so. So to see that hit hard like this, this hits hard on the level of personality. This hits real hard. I mean, just the pools, the gorgeous pools that they had, you know, just, it's just the ultimate in personality luxury, that place, Quixmala. So this really is a severe goat punch to the gut for the personality. Now, I know I would have been devastated by that, you know, in years gone by, without practice, without walking together in the wow. But now it doesn't bother me at all. Because the personality, that's what the personality dreams about. You know, oh yeah, this is it. Once I get that, I've made it. I remember finding such a place, but it was a complete low budget place. But I thought, oh, I don't even need money. But it was, ended up getting eaten alive by mosquitoes. I said, yeah, it was like the one, maybe the worst experience in my life. It was terrible. So somehow this started moving me away from the personality. Right? Saying it doesn't always work out the way you think it should. They say that everything here is a reflection of thinking. So even mosquitoes are a reflection of thinking. Absolutely. A very biting, painful, you know, this, so to speak, that comes back and bites us. Now, here's another thing that's pretty interesting. A lot of these low-lying places, third world countries, island countries, a lot of places, believe it or not, the 1%ers, the social engineers, the uber powerful, they have a lot of resorts all over the world, actually. Super sequestered, secret hideouts, hangouts. And most of those are on these islands, okay, that global warming may destroy these resorts, okay? So they're very, very much invested. Their personality is in preventing global warming. The vested interest, they don't want their gorgeous jewel of a resort to be wiped out by typhoons, hurricanes, and sea level rise. This bothers them immensely. Bothers the personality immensely. And I know this is how the personality is. They think, you know, they need to get away from the world, and they found their getaway. And this is all important to the personality. It's their first love is this hideaway. Or the, you know, nobody can get to me kind of thing. This is just perfect, idyllic. And to think that could be destroyed, you know, this just burns them no end. So a lot of them become eco freaks, really do. Because they say, hey, wait a minute, you know, my little billionaire resort might get hit by a hurricane. I don't want that. They say, stop. Of course, they tell everybody else to go minimalist, and they keep jet setting around the world, building these resorts, living the life of luxury all over the place. Huge carbon footprint. Getting massive money from all these massive industries. They want the rest of us to foot the bill, as always. But guess what? It might not work out that way for them. Doing here, moving along, very good, just relaxing here in the wow. So when there's a great breakthrough, honor time by spending time in the wow. This is part of the deal here. Remember, we're honoring time. We're shifting from worshiping time to honoring time. This is all important, because when you make this shift, it leads then to shifting out of the personality into spirit. So it is part of our practice to full stop in the wow. This is central to it. Without that, there is no practice here, actually. It's central. We made a deal. We made a deal with worshiping time, all the time-worshiping aspects of our experiencing and of our projecting. We made a deal and saying, okay, we won't try to attack you or revile you or abandon you or anything. We're going to go into honoring time, and we'll call that good. And then you get this inner agreement that says, okay, that's acceptable. We'll make that agreement. So of course we have to abide by this agreement, and it's to our benefit to do so, because it speeds up our spiritual path immeasurably. No longer tilting at windmills like Don Quixote. So it is the central part of what we do. Repentance, path of repentance, is this honoring of time and the honoring of the deal that we've made with worshiping time. To get out of worshiping time, you need to make this deal. We have to make the deal. Otherwise, worshiping time will just battle you. You've been this horrible battle with the personality. Terrible. And the way the world's going, you're likely to lose that battle, you know? The personality is so intense in this world now. You don't want to get in a battle with the personality. So say, the personality is not my enemy. You know, it's my friend now, because it's agreed. We have a deal. We have this working partnership where the personality is no longer, you know, it's just not a battle anymore. It's just saying, hey, I go for it, you know? You know, I'm all for honoring time. This is where now it's at. And it's not, you know, in antagonism or opposition to you. Interesting, that dream I had 2 nights ago of being in a jungle with these big trees. I thought it looked like I was in some sort of jungle. And we were climbing up all these trees, and then we saw this wild man who was trying to tell us, you know, to advise us and tell us what to do. And I said, and he suddenly fell, and this dead branch broke off the tree and fell all the way to the floor. This could have represented the personality of this Quixmala. Could have represented this Quixmala situation and the A-list personalities who think that they're the authority over us, you know. And suddenly that dropped away very severely. And I was, you know, saddened to see the severity of it, actually. I said, wow, maybe we can cushion the fall a little bit, you know. You don't wish harm on anyone. But they took a very severe fall. Very severe fall. So let's soften the landing. I mean, we're all members of one spiritual family, all with perfect standing in God. Equal, not even equal, perfect. You know, it's better to say perfect standing. Instead of equal, we start judging at a certain level of equality. What does that mean? No, perfect standing. We're all members in perfect standing of the one eternal spiritual family of spirit, of God, of isness, nowness, perfect authority, reality, truth, love, freedom, bliss. We're all glory, flowing of experiencing. We're all perfect in perfect good standing. So perfect standing. So there's no exception to that. So why not soften the blow? Why not help out? There for the grace of God go I. I mean, at some point we were dancing the dance of personality too, as they are doing now. So, you know, they have to repent as we have repented. So help them out. Show them the way. Maybe they'll invest in their own future repentance in some way possible. I don't know. It would be the best investment they ever made, that is for sure. But who's to say? We all need to invest in our repentance. So, what's the center here? The wow. Walking together in the wow is the deal we make. Intermediate step, as it were. So we honor the wow. This is how we're honoring time, because other than that, we'd assert our authority, you know. And there is no time, space, process, or form at all. There's only our flawless authority. We just abide in that. So to honor time, we do spend time in this wow reaction, and we need to, because of the continuity fear, you know, makes it prohibitively difficult to just leap and shift and just abide in that forever, you know. We feel a wow reaction to it. So we just say, honor the wow reaction is honoring time, honoring the deal we've made. And we will find that our spiritual path quickens to you know, an extraordinary degree. That we end up having gentle breakthroughs that are extraordinary. Because then we can just honor the wow of it, and that's all we need to do. That's all we need to do. Once we honor the wow of it, we're free to then make another breakthrough. That's how quick it goes. This hasn't been my experience. Because we're not struggling with the personality at all. As long as we're honoring the wow, we're honoring our deal with the personality. Personality won't get in our way, really. So then we're free to take the next big step and get familiar, free to work on familiarity. World Series starts Tuesday. Congratulations, Kansas City Royals and New York Mets. That'll be a great series. Really great. The Mets will need some miracles to win that one, but they have a history of miracles in the World Series. The 86 against Boston. Notorious ground ball between the legs. That would have given Boston the World Series win. Instead, the Mets end up winning. So now here we go again in 2015. The Mets are back. Maybe it's the Mets will have another miracle. We'll see. But they're going to need it. Kansas City's like a shark, you know, great white shark. It really, it just keeps coming and keeps chomping at you. I mean, they don't let up. October 27th, Tuesday, starting, wow. Beginning for me of the great play of sadhana, of spirituality, the great spirituality sadhana practice that Anandamayi Ma initiated with me in October 27th, 1997. That's why I began that. The whole spirituality thing, you know, put myself through boot camp of that in Just not announcing it, just doing it quietly, unobtrusively, just saying, okay. All the bells and whistles, and the backdrops, and the ornamentation, and the shrines, and the photography, and just did the whole glamour of the spirituality, you know, went through that whole glamour of all that. For quite some time, actually. How long? Maybe seven years of that. The songs, the music, you know, the extravaganzas. The flowers. the bhakti, the chanting, everything, all this stuff, you know. So, and yet here we are practicing this shift and realizing this is where it's really at. There's no doubt about it. It's clearly simply accepting our authority. That's all it is. It's an authority issue entirely. And the personality is bluffing us, telling us if we give up our authority, it'll go easy on us when it has sole authority. It's all a bluff, 100%. And yet our continuity fear doesn't want to call that bluff too quickly, so we practice, gradually practice calling the bluff, but not really in an antagonistic way. It's not an antagonism now. Thank the personality. Say, thank you, personality. Just be, you can be here, just be quiet, just sitting there, just stay. I'm very happy you're here. Very happy for your help. And I'm very happy to honor the creativity that went into the personality and the bluff and all that. How clever. It's all just a bluff, actually. And our entire problem is just, it's just a bluff. We've bluffed ourselves. That's it. That's it. The personality is holding no cards at all. But it's, so we've just been bluffing ourselves. That's it. In a nutshell, that's it. In terms of authority. Personality has no real authority at all. It's just that we've been trying to give up our authority, pretending we don't have it, hoping that the personality, when it gains authority, will go easy on us. So we keep thinking that we don't have the authority, but we actually do. All we need to do is reassert and remember, oh, I really do have this perfect authority, this seamless light, this perfect, flawless, seamless light is all there is, and it's everywhere there is, always and forever. There's no opposition to that whatsoever. I'm absolutely perfect. I feel absolutely perfect. This is my authority. I'm fully vested in my authority. My authority is fully vested in all there is, without any exception whatsoever. Keep sitting up straight here. Now when we say this, the wow kicks up strong. Absolutely it does. Of course. But the proof of getting to this practice is proof of the extreme effectiveness of this way. And of course, extreme effectiveness can only come when you're able to handle the success of it. So by practicing, honoring time through this wow reaction, this is the managing of our success. As soon as we get away from this, we start projecting the personality again, and the personality seems to flare up on us. But if we don't get away from full stop on the wild, the personality doesn't flare up on us. Hardly at all. Yeah? It just stays quiet. Because we're not asking it to. We're saying, just sit quietly, personality. That's all I need from you now. Just sit quietly. No thoughts. I have no thoughts at all about my authority. None are needed. Authority is entirely present right here, right now. Therefore, no thoughts are needed whatsoever. I have no reaction to my authority. None is needed. My authority is seamless, seamlessly flawless, everywhere, always, in all ways. There's no need to judge it, no need to think about it, no need to react to it. It simply is what is. My authority simply is all that is. we need this now, don't we? This hurricane is a attention getter. If Haiphong or in Tacloban, Philippines, as if that wasn't one, that was certainly a big one. I really reacted to that one strongly with great, you know, dismay. That was a catastrophic tragedy, to say the least. So, but this one here, the specificity of this boomerang effect was quite extraordinary. So personality worshippers are getting hammered right now. The boomerang is coming back on them. Put our attention on spirit, which is this sovereign authority. You can tell in the eyes of the great sages. You can tell that they have some other authority. It's not the personality authority. In fact, they dismiss that. You know, it's not part of their being, is it? You can tell that. Well, that's where. But even more important, put our attention on the wow and the patience and honoring our agreement. Just honoring our agreement. Okay, now I'm going to give a little break to focus on the wow here. I'm going to walk around a little bit. I'm starting to get a little bit too achy at this point. So I'm going to just walk around a little bit, be right back, honor the wow, stay in the wow. This is very intense. Just sit quietly. Okay. Beautiful day here, hazy, beautiful feel to it. There's nothing like California in as it gets towards the, you know, winter months and November, December, January. When you get these beautiful days, you know, it just feels like summer. I mean, just the high pressure is just so beautiful, and just like wow. Wow, that's a personality reaction, though. Right, so we're not focused on the personality so much at this point, right? In terms of its wow. But we at least acknowledge it. There's no problem. The harmony, the deal's made, so. But we don't focus on it. We don't deny it. We're not trying to deny. We don't need to. We have our deal. We're honoring time here with the wow and practicing the shift, realizing, oh, it is possible. So I don't pay that much attention to the weather anymore. I'll just notice it briefly and then I'll say, okay, and go back to practicing. Whereas in the past, you know, I was a weather junkie. Absolutely. Good weather junkie. It was like heroin to me. It's because it's the personality. This is what the personality loves. Looking for the perfect place, the perfect weather, the most idyllic spot. So the personality can say, look at how great this projection is. Look at what I'm going to have authority over. How wonderful it is. You know, it sort of gives a boost to the personality. But we appreciate it here. I mean, we appreciate it. But it must not become a fixation. And it can become a fixation, no question about it. The whole no water thing here is mental. It's the mental projections of everybody here, actually. And that is that we don't want bad weather. We want every day to be perfect. And so we don't want the rain. We don't want the cloudiness. We don't want the storms. You know, this is the problem here. People have to change their mindset a little bit here and start welcoming the storms. It's hard to do, but we have to do it. I'm aware of that. This is the mindset here. We want perfect weather every day. Whoops, no water. Uh-oh. Again, the great sages tell us this world is a mental projection. The weather, everything we experience here is a mental projection. Actually, it is. And so, you know, it's hard to fathom, but there are those in hot areas of the world who may look to the northern areas, cooler areas, and they say, hey, I want to live there. So they want it to heat up where they are. Give them an excuse to migrate. Excuse, hey, I got to leave. It's too hot. The crops have failed. I'm headed to these wonderful, fertile areas. This is actually what's going on beneath the surface, you know, is making strategies, making excuses, all this stuff. The mental play beneath the surface is what's really, this whole atmosphere is just thought. Everything we're experiencing in this world is just thought, actually. Just our thinking. It's just our thinking. There's nothing outside of the mind. And when we're trying to deceive God, we get into thinking. All right? Time, space, process, and form. But still, it's only our mind. There's nothing outside of the mind. There is no way to be outside of our mind, the one mind. You see all these people flooding into Europe. Rich, wealthy, you know, infrastructure, right? What are they going for? Infrastructure. It's all there. So they got a great excuse. Oh, it's too dangerous where we are. There's a big war there. We got to leave. People will understand, they'll accept us, off we go, settle down in Germany, you know, nice place, settle down in France, settle down here, in Spain, whatever, nice apartment buildings, beautiful roads, hospitals, healthcare, food, everything. Wow, this is nice. So compliments to those teachers who have not yet really bought into anthropogenic, as far as, you know, global warming based on just, you know, burning coal and all this kind of stuff. And they're saying, no, it's really just, this is all just a mental projection. It's our mind, actually. If we work at the mind, this is what will really cure whatever issues we have, change it. Problem is that everybody has different ideas, you know, personality ideas. And the level of personality is always going to be conflict. There's always going to be, it's never enough. It's never enough. The grass is always greener. You covet your neighbor's wife, so to speak. And so you can give out all these rules for the personality, but that doesn't solve the problem at all. That's why Jesus brought a New Testament, a spiritual testament, instead of the old Mosaic Testament, which was personality. Rules and laws for the personality. Jesus said that's not going to get it done at all. You got to make this shift. You have to make this shift of authority from personality to spirit. This is what Jesus came to tell us and returned again, 1965, October 21st, to tell us again. This time, more emphasis. He emphasized it, you know, had to go easy at first, but now he's, you know, much stronger emphasis for us because the personality is now really bringing about big problems for itself. Absolutely. Personality is going to suffer here very badly if, you know, the blows are not softened. Now maybe we are able to soften, for sure. We did soften Hurricane Patricia. We were able to at least, you know, it wasn't as bad as they feared. Because you can't say that we really have a true problem if it's only a personality problem. It's a bluff problem. It's just bluffing. Saying, hey, spirit, I'm going to look at this problem I'm going to cause you if you don't give up your authority to me. Acknowledge my authority, or give up your own authority by acknowledging that I'm going to be sovereign. And you know, here's a problem you're going to have. It's a bluff problem. That problem could shift, and there's no problem. There's only complete flawlessness. That's all there is, everywhere. It's like a hallucination, this world. I mean, we're hallucinating problems and claiming they're real problems. They're not real problems. Again, kudos to those teachers in the world right now who are still holding a line on this. If there are any left. But and they should speak up. I mean, just to be silent on this is... You know, it's not necessarily a good thing because people are thinking like, well, this is the personality approach is the only approach there is. The United Nations is a personality approach entirely. This is why it's very troublesome. It seems great to the personality because the personality thinks this is all we can do. But it actually is sowing the seeds of greater problems. Severe delay in shifting authority, of calling the bluff of the personality, really, and spirit once again accepting its true authority, saying, wow, spirit's afraid to accept its authority, thinking that then the personality will condemn it to annihilation once it gains control. So I said, okay, personality, don't go too rough on me. So it's afraid to accept its authority, so it keeps pretending it doesn't have the authority, and that's this dance of the personality. This is what the personality has no authority. It's spirit doing all of this. Personality is not doing any of it. But spirit is pretending that it's the personality that's doing it. Say, look, personality, I'm pretending you're strong and have authority, just so you won't go so you go easy on me. So I'm pretending that you have it, but it's really spirit pretending all of this, all of it. So, of course, spirit has complete authority over all this. He wants global warming to end this instant. In fact, it's never been. You know, you could say it's never been. We have the authority to say that. It's never been. There's never been the slightest problem here. And we can see it that way. And absolutely we can. We can see the world as all having always been perfect. We have the authority to see it that way. So again, what I'm pointing out, the trouble here, we're getting to is United Nations, a personality approach. The personality, trying to solve the personality issue problem, it doesn't work. It'll never work. It makes it worse. Because really, spirit is just heightening the pretense that somehow personality is doing something when in fact it's doing nothing. 100% without any exception, it's all spirit that's doing all of this. Always has been, always will be. There's no personality, real personality at all. It has no causative effect, power whatsoever, zero. And yet we're going along with the pretense that it does. This is not good. And, you know, of course, there's all those posing as the good personality. I'm the good personality. I'm the good witch. the wicked witch is bad, but I'm the good witch, and I'm the good personality. I'm the good pretense, you know. And I'm positively causative personality. The others were negative causative personality. I got to get rid of the dark causative personality because I'm the light causative personality. You know, this is, you know, strengthening delusion, actually. This is why the great sages don't get into all the social work and planetary work and eco work. And Nanda Maima didn't do anything wrong, or she didn't do anything. Hardly at all. I mean, they badgered her and badgered her. Can you lend your name to this hospital we're doing? She goes, yeah, well, okay, as long as you set it up this way and this way and this way and emphasize right spiritual practice and stuff. And, you know, but they said, no, I'm not into that. Not into that. The world's already perfect. I see it absolutely flawlessly perfect. There's nowhere where my authority, spiritual authority, is being challenged at all. So how could I not be perfect? But the personality dance is you get all these, you know, I'm the good witch. Follow me. I'll be positively causative personality. This, again, is heightening delusion. Now, these teachers do miracles. You know, for example, Nanda Maima did many, many miracles. If the people would say, look, okay, make it rain. She goes, I don't have any, you know, it may rain, it may not, you know. And I said, I said, okay, so look, we acknowledge that our personalities, we are not causative. We don't have causative. We can't make it rain. We're not able to. We don't have it. And we appeal to the divine, you know, only divine can make it rain for us. And so in other words, when the people repented, had an attitude of repentance, then lo and behold, huge amount of rain would come into a drought-stricken area when she was, you know, there. Just, okay. Of course, it'd be so much rain, it wouldn't stop. And then they'd say, stop the rain, stop the rain. She'd go, okay. Like, oh, the rain stopped. How about that? It's when the repentant attitude brought the miracles, the people experienced miracles. When they're willing to see that this did not come from the personality. Personality's helpless. Now, this is just, you know, kind of crude, but this is where they're at that point. It's sort of a crude demonstration like that. Healing, same thing. You know, Jesus did a lot of healing miracles. And they'd say, heal me, heal me, heal me, heal me. Jesus says, you know, I can't heal you. It's your faith that heals you. Are you willing to have faith and repent, repent, and sin no more? And they said, oh, yeah, I accept that you're, you know, the authority of divinity and the authority of personality is very suspect. You know, I don't really trust it anymore. And so they're willing for a moment to, you know, make a shift there, accept a shift, and pow, you know, their illness vanishes instantly, as authority. Instantly, if can, all trouble instantly vanishes because it's our authority that it do so. This appearancing, any evidence that our authority isn't perfect instantly advantages, instantly disappears when we accept our authority as such. It's like the sick people come to Jesus and say, hey, Jesus, this is an example that your authority isn't perfect. And Jesus says, no, my authority is perfect. And I'll put you to the test, Jesus, and pow, illness is gone. Divine authority is perfect. Our authority, spiritual authority, is perfect. There's no illness that changes that in the slightest way. No appearance that we call illness. It's just an appearance that we're labeling as illness. Really nothing at all, but an appearance, an empty appearance, already self-released in the now, perfectly so. It has no real qualities that we can label as going against spiritual will. No, not at all. It's not going against spiritual will. We're just labeling it as such. You know, it's a bluff. It's not causative. Effects are not causative. Effects coming from a cause are not their own cause. nor can they change the cause. They have no effect on the cause. This is the way reality is. And so this is the way all is. Oh, 158. Wow. Now, the personality, of course, does constantly active in the world by those who are not, you know, haven't made this deal of walking together in the wow and doing this. They're still functioning from the level of personality, and so they have these ego retreats, these spiritual ego retreats, you know, these green spiritual ego retreats. This is a very big business in the world, will now become, you know, very, very big and important and sustainability this, sustainability that. And so they'll go to this beautiful, they'll have a beautiful cruise to the Aegean Sea. And, you know, oh yes, we'll focus on this spiritual book or this spiritual teaching. And then they'll go to some resort in a beautiful island, Greek island, on the beach there. And they'll have like really, really organic food, green, sustainable food, you know. And they'll do singing and chanting and dancing and art. And they'll, you know, sunbathe and swim in the beautiful ocean. They'll take walks. They'll form wonderful friendships. And they'll talk about, you know, how positive they are, etc. And, you know, they'll go back to and say, ah, oh, I'm really so refreshed. I feel like a positive personality now. And this is what's going on. This is what, is intensifying. This is the personality. This is the unrepentant personality trying to spiritualize itself to, you know, which it's really the unrepentant personality is just spirit doing the continuity fear dance, not knowing how to truly dissipate evaporate the continuity fear, not yet making the deal of the wow, thinking, no, I can get around that deal. You know, that's the personality is really, you know, it's a trap. And yeah, of course they will regurgitate some teachings from some holy book or something, of course, yeah. But they're not, it's all about willingness to experience the wow, be patient with the wow, full stop in the wow. This then gives rise to really seeing and experiencing and recognizing the insights, the true insights, the deep insights that are needed, and just, wow, I really saw it. This is different than reading something from a book where they say, well, you know, after I read the book, we'll go down and play guitar on the beach. Lunchtime. Look at this wonderful Greek food we have for you. Awesome. And then the wine, too. Oh, look at the wine list. Oh, my gosh. You know, we spent a lot of time on this wine list. And we've really matched up well with the food, you know, and it's going to clean your palate. It'll be a whole new awesome experience. And it's okay if you drink a little too much. We're here to relax anyway. Right? And of course, soon there'll be all sorts of drugs. There already have been, you know, but it will be very prevalent. So this will really help your mood. This is a mood enhancer, a spiritual mood enhancer. It's a personality, positive personality, mood enhancer. It's good. It helps us feel more open to others. more like one with them, with the personality. My personality is one with your personality. All this stuff of oneness and groups, it's all the level of personality. Let's get together in oneness of a personality. That's not, you know, that's not where it's at, okay? The real oneness is we assume, we accept our spiritual sovereignty, which is, I am the only, you know, I am the one authority, period. There is no other. My authority extends everywhere. It's so, they're so flawless, there's no circumstances or situations could ever arise. It's unchallenged authority. This is true spiritual authority. It's really talking about our freedom, isn't it? Absolute freedom. For any experiencing we want. So, the personality is all into this personality oneness thing. Let's hold hands and sing Kumbaya and groove to that. And yeah, we're all one at the level of the personality. This intensifies the bluff, really. It says we're getting there. See, that spirit has, you know, been willing to share its authority with the personality. Now the personality is going to make a beautiful world out of that. And it's backwards, upside down and backwards. So if you're not eco-spiritual tripping, that spirit eco-spiritual, eco-spirit tripping, that's fine. ESP, eco-spiritual personality. Eco-spirit tripping. ESP. What's the P stand for? Personality, eco-spirit, ESP tripping, eco-spirit personality tripping. This is what's going on. And if you're not doing that, it great. Great, 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 great. But boy, does it get the personality involved, doesn't it? It's like, what am I going to wear? What am I going to wear? How can I make the body look great without overdoing it? I want to make look like how supple and toned and tanned and healthy this body is, and it's a sign of a healthy personality. And but let me make sure I'm wearing the correct eco linen. You know, I mean, this is linen, and make sure it's not, you know, it wasn't done in a sweat factory. There's no GMOs involved, and my clothing reflect the purity of my personality. At the same time, the attractiveness of the body reflects the attractiveness of my personality. I'm a very attractive personality, you know? And they're doing all these affirmations to, I'm an attractive personality, I'm a wonderful personality, I get along with other personalities, I'm very attractive to all their personalities, I'm attracting symbols of my attractiveness to this attractive personality, you know, this is this buzz, and then they throw some non-dual spin on this, kind of like, you know, yeah, and it's also non-dual attractiveness of the attractive personality. This is what's selling to the personality, of course. So there's this massive, massive global, you know, inundation of personality, you know, ESP tripping, eco-spiritual personality tripping is going to be, this could come about very rapidly. It could coalesce, crystallize very rapidly. There'll be some conversion. Maybe Trump and Hillary will form a unified ticket, an eco ticket, and say, yeah, you know what? This is where it's at. They'll hold hands, you know, and meditate together. Not really personality meditation. Say, wow, what an attractive ticket that is. You know, the whole world will say, oh, isn't that cute? We're going to do that too. And, you know, there's something that's going to happen, but like, Boomerang will happen very quickly. The Donald and the Fraulein. There'll be songs about it. They both had an awakening, you know. It's like now they're I'm okay, you're okay. Why do we need all this partisan stuff? Climate's being destroyed. We need to join hands and let's Again, this climate is a complete pretension of spirit. It's nothing but a pretense. Recognize spiritual authority, and there is no trouble at all. Not in your authority at all. Others can keep pretending there's a problem, but you'll see there isn't any. There's none, no problem whatsoever. All is perfect. Ananda, my mom would say, everything is perfect. Everything is flawless right here, right now. What are you talking about, problems? I say, but Mom, there's World War II, and there's bombs, and everyone's killing each other. I say, what are you talking about? She says, these are just dear, dear friends playing a silly little game that they're enjoying. There's no problem at all. Everything's perfect. These people are dying. It's just, no, they're just falling down, pretending to be asleep, and then getting back up again and doing it again. There's nothing amiss. There's no spiritual authority problem at all. Huh. So we need to be saying that today, right now. Well, there's no ego problem at all, actually. It doesn't exist. It's all 100% spiritual pretense. But our authority can never be affected in any way. Is there some global climate change problem that's affecting our spiritual authority? None whatsoever. It's a complete bluff. Is there a severe bluff going on? Yes. Yes. So is the personality going to be affected? Of course. But it's really, even the effect on the personality is all bluff, spiritual bluff, because personality is really not experiencing anything. It's just, this is just an imagination that there's a personality. It's all spirit doing all of this. This is why we say the personality just sit quietly. Because that's its true state. It's not doing anything. It's inert. It's neutral. You know? It doesn't really exist at all. Except in our imagination. Really trying to bluff God is what we're trying to do. But we're acting out the bluff on God. Saying, hey God, look at this. This bluff is real. This personality is really holding the cards. It says it is. You know, look what's happening to us. We're losing our authority. Preemptively saying that, you know, like, well, we're not really losing it. God says, really? He said, well, not really, but we're pretending to, because personality will go easy on us once it's the prime creator. And God says, well, really? I thought I was the prime creator. yeah. You'll see these ego resort retreats are everywhere now. They're becoming even more everywhereness. You know, the breadwinner goes out and makes, you know, as much money as possible, stocks, everything, then they retire, and the spouse then often, you know, sets up these ego retreats. This is what I'm into. I gotta do something, you know, I'm so wealthy and don't have to work or anything. Oh, come to my ego retreat, come to my ego retreat. Eco-spirit retreat. Eco-spirituality, you know. Oh yeah, I've got my dreadlocks, I've attended properly, you know, and it's frizzy, you know, backcombed enough to make it look like it's really third worldy, and I've woven, you know, natural bead work into my dreads to honor, you know, the indigenous people of this area, and we're doing pilgrimages to the grave sites of the indigenous people here, setting up a little stone shrine to the nature goddesses of the area. We're chanting to the sea and nature, how lovely it is, and going on this awesome, you know, sustainable diet here, and we're going barefoot to honor the earth, our connection with the earth. And it's just endless. It's just endless, right? We're putting on plays, you know, sacrificing what we love best to nature, to say, nature, here, we're sorry, we mistreated you. Let us sacrifice what we love best here, because we know you've sacrificed so much, so let us sacrifice to you so you won't be so severe on us. We deserve all punishment, nature, for all the sins we've committed as personalities. Again, this is just strengthening self-delusion, spiritual delusion, just strengthening it. And of course, they'll, like I said, bring in some holy book. They'll bring in A Course in Miracles, for God's sakes. And, you know, today we'll, you know, look at this practice and for a few minutes, and then we'll feel good about ourselves and say we're good little personalities and who deserve to be slaughtered by nature, but we're going to, you know, try to use vicarious atonement and somehow preempt that. And then we'll get back to vicarious atonement sacrifice, and then we're back to Jesus' first time around, you know, and we'll get back to that. And it's like they're missing the boat. They're totally missing the boat. Yeah, I am the only authority there is. I am the only authority there is. There is no other authority. Personality, just sit there. Body, just sit there quietly. Don't need to do anything. Don't need to shout hallelujah. I am the only authority there is. There is no other authority. And, of course, we know I am is God. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. I am. I am the only authority is God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Or if you're a strict monotheist, then you just say is God. Okay? Or I mean a non-Trinitarian. Like Islam's non-Trinitarian, so you can say just I am God, right? I am the sole authority. And Trinitarians understand that by saying Trinitarian, it's strict monotheism also. But understanding that there's God the Prime Creator, God the Prime Created, and God the Blessing upon all of creation. Once God the Prime Created wanted to see if it could be the Prime Creator, which is this detour into, you know, fear that we've got, that we're struggling with here. So this is why using a Trinitarian position is very, very helpful to make this deal we need to make. The Holy Spirit is, putting the Holy Spirit in there is supremely important. Very helpful. But strict, you know, non-Trinitarians also have a way of wiggling around this and getting the grace of God too. You know, they just, for some reason, they like to present it that way. So, but there's only one authority, and that is I am. I am the one authority. I am the sole authority. There is no other authority. Never has been and never will be. So the problem comes when those are not repentant. That personality is still in charge. They're not willing to practice. They still want to make a deal. Well, and I have to just tell them, well, the deal you need to make is full stop in the wow. That's it. You have to honor time. You cannot go from worshiping time to full authority. That's what the personality wants to do. The personality wants to go from worshiping time to ultimately being the Prime Creator, the new Prime Creator. It's not possible. It's impossible. It cannot ever happen that way. So it cannot happen in any way. So what the personality has to, the spirit has to accept this and then make a deal with its continuity fear, which is, you know, projecting of the personality is the dance of continuity fear, and say, okay, let's keep that dance, you know, but let's let it be minimal. We agree to that, and I'll honor time through the full stop and the wow. And once one does that, then the practicing goes smoothly. There isn't all this argumentation taking place at all, and kibitzing and quibbling and all this stuff doesn't even arise. If you haven't repented, the spirit has not repented, then there's all this quibbling and arguing taking place about, well, between the personalities, if there's some big deal yet to be made. No, we've already made the deal. So that's finished. It's finished. There's no need here. There's no need to worry about that. All the deal's already been made. We know what the deal is. So we just get to practicing. That's it. And you can use any term you want, but you know, the bottom line is it's neither this nor that. It's just wow. It's a mixture of elation and fear is what it really is. You can give it some exotic name if you want, whatever, but you know, no, it's still the same. It's like water is water, H2. I mean, it's the same, whatever you call it. I just choose, you know, to use the term wow. It's very expressive of it. It just, when you're saying wow, you're not saying yes or no, you know. It's like someone says, hey, do you want to marry me? And you say, wow. You're not saying yes or no, you're just saying, wow, this is shocking. There's some yes and there's some no there, you know. It's like, wow. So people have the experience, you know, in the personality level of romance, special relationships, it's like they're confronted with a relationship and they just say, well, you know, wow. Oh, wow. You know, they say, oh, wow. It's kind of like that. It's like kind of like that, right? Oh, wow. I'm getting a proposal here. And so they don't really say yes or no. It's not really yes or no. It's just, wow. I need to let this wow settle down because this is, you know, I don't know what to say at all. So it's intentionally saying, I don't know what to say. I don't have a position. See, it's neither this nor that. I'm neither saying yes, nor am I not saying yes. I'm neither saying no, nor am I not saying no. It's neither nor. It's a wow. The repentant spirit will find this to be extraordinarily helpful. And the unrepentant spirit will continue to spin its wheels and gnash its teeth and jump around rambunctiously and posture and, you know, all this unfortunate stuff and gets nowhere. Just seems to be going on. Get the person I love to run around, seem to be going everywhere, you know, as far as, you know, like, oh yeah, I did this ego retreat, ESP retreat, this ESP retreat, this ESP retreat. I'm really into ESP, ego, spiritual personality retreating. But it's not getting anywhere. It's actually strengthening the delusion. Which an unrepentant spirit feels it must do so. Says, oh my gosh, the spirit's going, I mean, personality is going to be the new prime creator. So I've got to really show that I'm really doing what it wants me to do. I'm really into this stuff. I care. I care about the personality, really. I really care about it, you know. And I understand its needs. I'm taking care of its needs. I'm feeding it the personality really well. And not just giving it fruit smoothies in the morning. Come on, you know. It's funny because I'm getting all these delicacies too. Here. Free. Like some of the finest personality delicacies possible. They'd be serving that in some ultra resort. Quixmala or something, you know. French pastries. Oh, super fancy French pastries. You know, and so something like that, you know, just delicacies. And so I get the person, oh, here's a little delicacy, all right, oh, it's nice, and no real interest in it. And after a while, you know, you don't even need that stuff anymore. But it, you know, it's like balancing out my fruit smoothie diet. I can go eat a eclair, you know, chocolate eclair, custard eclair, or at least to take a bite out of it. I just take a bite out of it. Let's say, okay, that's it. Don't eat any more. Oh, it was kind of tasty, but not really. You taste the sugar there. It's like, nah, not really. Doesn't really taste very good at all, actually. But yeah, that you know eases the personality whole thing maybe a little. I don't know. We don't have to overdo it. Some of this stuff just helps us say no, you know, on a personality, quote-unquote, level. I get free tickets. You want to go free tickets? There's, you know, I'd passed on the golf thing. I talked to somebody that got the tickets and went. Someone I know. How was this? Oh my gosh, this is unbelievable. You know, unbelievable. Hospitality tent, 18th green. All the food and drink you could have free. And it's just like, wow, what a party. You know, it was just like, it was awesome. Total indulgence. It was for him, it was great. I'm sure he indulged it. For me, what was great was the turning it down was great. That was a great experience. That was a better experience than going. I mean, what kind of food could they have that would possibly, you know, be awesome for me? Really? No. What? What could it be? I don't know. What could? I've already, you know, had it all, so to speak. I've been vegetarian, but, I mean, no. I mean, and then what kind of desserts could they have had that could have been awesome? I've had been there, done that. Drinks. I don't drink, but the health drinks, what kind of health drink could they have had? It could be awesome. I've already been there, done that. Alcoholic drinks, those are never awesome, really, right? So what could they, you know, turning it down, I mean, well, the course, is the course that awesome? No. Been to much better courses than that. The crowd, awesome? No. Been to more awesome crowds. The scene, no. You've been to more awesome scenes than that. Like a President's Cup or U.S. Open or something like that. Well, so, what's awesome about it? Nothing, really. I've been to a hospitality tent. I know what it's like. Eh, it's not that. Been there, done that. It's not so awesome. It's U.S. Open, for God's sakes. People, are they awesome? No. They're just personalities. It's all tripping all over themselves. Trying to, you know, it's just, it actually, it's sad. It's sad. It's a pity. So, yeah. So turning it down was the kick. You know, that becomes the kick. And then I keep getting all these offers. I keep turning them down. I think that the Spirit is giving me this opportunity to turn it down. Now, that's the kick now. I said, nah, no thanks, can't make it. Somebody else can make it there. That's the kick. I really want to hang out with personality. Spirit pretending to be personality heavily dancing like this. Do I really want to hang out with a continuity dance of continuity fear, severe dance of continuity fear? No. Thanks, but no thanks. I didn't like hate on it. I just said, well, you know, not anymore. I was going through the manual of this car, and it's terrible. I hate the new cars. I like the ride. The ride's good. But it's so over-engineered with so many bells and whistles. It's pathetic. It is just pathetic. Good Lord. I mean, you could literally spend your whole life just going through all these options that are presented to us now. It's ridiculous. You know, everything has got way too many options. Just as menu now they have on the touchscreen menu. You know, it just goes on and on and on and on and on. Catering to every possible whim they can think of. I just want a good ride, thank you. And it is a good ride, so that's cool. Personality likes that. But yeah, they had good rides back in the 60s. Lincoln Continentals, Cadillacs, Buicks, I mean, Oldsmobile. I mean, they had some luxury rides back then. The T-Bird, I mean, come on. You had a clock, showed you the time. You had some, you know, at some point they had AC. Super quiet, smooth ride. That's good. I'm good. Even had a radio. You could, you know, tune into top 40 station or whatever you want. That's good enough. Nowadays, no. You got to have every possible combination of sophistication all packed in there, and it gets all so confusing. There's so many lights and bells and whistles. Light goes on. What is that light? I don't know what that light is. You know, it's just so many things that are just catering. And again, who wants to spend their time going through reading manuals, going through options? This is just could consume people's lives. It does. It consumed my life previously. I said, this is it. I've had enough of that. I said, I don't want a smartphone. I won't know 99% of all the options on there. Plus, I won't use any apps. So, you know, millions of apps. I never, you know, this. Why do I even want to get close to that temptation? Stay far away from it. It's a massive waste of time. This is the personality going nuts, you know. This is the dance of continuity. Fear investing in the personality is all it is. Catering to the body, catering to the personality. We don't want to do this. This is a disaster. So the temptation is there, you know, is, wow, why do I want this? Just give me a car that, you know, handles well, accelerates well, brakes well, good visibility, which they don't have good visibility in cars anymore. The way they're engineered, you can't see out the back or the side. It's terrible. I love the old cars that had good visibility. That's number one for me, is visibility. I got this minivan from my uncle one time. It's a Chrysler caravan, Dodge caravan, I think, minivan. Oh my gosh, the visibility was fantastic. I loved it. I didn't even think it had headrests. You know, you're sitting up high, you just look and you just see the whole road. Everywhere you look, you see the whole road. This is what I want in a vehicle. I want to be able to see, you know. These days now in the cars, you actually, when you turn your turn signal, the camera goes on the console and shows you the lane to the right, the merge lane. If you're merging right, it shows you the whole lane by camera. So you just hit your turn signal, look at the console, and then go into the lane. I don't really like that. Backing up's the same thing. You start backing up, and you have video of three different views of videos: top, straight, down, narrower angle, wider angle. So you back up without even looking. I don't like that. I like to turn around and look. Okay, I like to look. So I don't like the new cars. Way over engineered. Bunch of stuff that just gets in the way. Give me good visibility. They can't seem to engineer good visibility for us anymore, can they? They absolutely cannot. That's why I like the minivans, you know, where they seem to have better visibility, but they're cutting down on that too. I hate the cars with no visibility. That's nuts. Got trust in the mirrors almost completely. Why do that? I'd rather look and just see for myself. So we're trusting in technology for our safety, like, completely. They're doing it on purpose, actually. I don't want to trust in technology for my safety. You know, trust in spirit. And the spirit says, hey, you know, just go ahead and look. You can look. It's okay to look. Okay, I looked. It's fine. You know, because this sets us up for an artificial reality, doesn't it? Entirely, that says, look, what technology is showing us is reality. We're setting up for a matrix thing entirely here. Artificial intelligence. We're going right into this matrix. You click, you look on a console. You say, okay, it's showing a camera. Oh, that's what's there. So in other words, what the camera is showing you is what's there. Well, guess what? The camera can show you anything that programmers want to show you. You know, they can show a monster in the right mirror. You're looking. You say, oh my God, there's a monster there. And it'll tell you, turn left, turn, must turn off here and get away from the monster. Oh my gosh, yes, I must go there. It'll actually have software that'll automatically take you there. And you just trust in the software. They have lane correction software now, on the cars, where if you start going and hit, you know, veering out of your lane in any way, it'll correct and put you, it'll steer you right back into your lane. Give a vibration, the steering wheel, and all this stuff. So they can artificially arrange a fake environment for you that you just think that that's where you are. And you need to drive into this underground garage to get away from Godzilla that's chasing you. I mean, you'll be looking in your console there and seeing a rear view or side view camera view, and Godzilla's after you. And you say, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. And then the software will say, oh my gosh, emergency, you're being chased by a monster. You need to go into this underground concrete garage immediately. And the car will then go into auto drive and take you right there. And you go, and you say, oh my God, I'm safe. That Godzilla almost caught me and ate me alive. Oh my gosh, this is what, oh, I need to stay here in this. And then there'll be cameras showing you a view of outside, and Godzilla's everywhere outside. You say, I need to stay in this bunker, because if I leave this bunker, I'll be eaten alive. That's what people are being programmed for, folks. That's why they're using dinosaurs, these terrible monsters, T-Rex and all this stuff, is to get you used to the idea of being chased by them and consumed by them. They see in the movies, T-Rex is eating, you know, picking up cars and eating them, so that at some point they'll show you a video of this in some realistic way, that you'll believe that they are here. You know, this Project Blue Beam is somewhere along those lines, right? Of artificial fake, you know, invasion of this planet. You'll think you are being invaded. It's on the news. You know, you're seeing it on your smartphone. You're seeing like a webcam is recording. Oh, look at these! All the webcams are picking this up. Oh, indeed, there's saucers landing here, saucers landing there. The webcams are showing us. It's on our smartphone. You know, you must take immediate. You know, go to these safe areas. You know, and in fact, there's nothing happening at all. This is what Project Blue Beam is really about. It's a faked alien invasion, actually, and we're getting very close to actually that being able to take place. We're so used to now just believing what we see on the screen is reality. And putting that in our cars trains all of us to believe in that. That's why I hate it. I hate it. I should be able to disable that stupid thing. And the engine of the stupid car, so you can't look, so you have to rely on it, you know? This is all part of it, actually. Trusting in what some video feed is showing you is that has to be reality, not realizing that they can substitute a GFI computer graphic imagery. CGI, computer generated imagery, CGI, computer generated imagery for what's the video feed, and you think that's what's actually the video camera is seeing, and it's not at all. It's not at all. And in fact, these body perception may very well be a CGI, computer generated imagery. The brain may be just a CGI factory. It's not really showing us what's present at all. This is what Jesus says. So we think we need to take refuge. So you end up going then right into their concentration camps or where they want you to be, thinking this is safety. And they're making holograms and stuff like that in concerts to get people used to that. Like, there's Elvis. You know, Elvis is here. Elvis has just come to visit us. Where it's just lasers, you know, holograms. They're getting the young people are getting ready to really train the young people to believe in a faith.